Calling all cars, a copyrighted program created by the Rio Grande Oil Company.
Calling all cars, attention all cars, attention all Maricopa County Sheriff's cars. Be on the lookout for a high-powered automobile with two men and a blonde woman in it. These subjects kidnapped the deputy sheriff and later threw him out of their car at Chandler and badly wounded him. That's all.
Years of research and millions of dollars have been spent by the worldwide Sinclair organization, of which Rio Grande is the Western unit, to perfect the famous cracking process, which is an exclusive patented process. Sinclair engineers built one of these great cracking plants for the Rio Grande Oil Company. And the only way you can get the advantages of this revolutionary process is to buy Rio Grande cracked gasoline from your independent dealer. The costly cracking process adds very definite advantages to Rio Grande gasoline, but it adds nothing to the cost you pay. You get a livelier gasoline with tetraethyl added at no extra cost. And when Rio Grande cracked gasoline reaches your carburetor, you'll find your car goes faster. The engine runs smoother. You can feel the extra power. All these extra advantages at no extra cost have induced leading Western cities to specify Rio Grande cracked gasoline for their emergency engines. Wherever it is sold, Rio Grande cracked powers more police cars, fire engines, ambulances, and other emergency equipment than any other brand of gasoline. If you will drive into a Rio Grande service station, you too will experience the thrill of police car performance in your own car. Sheriff J.R. McFadden of Maricopa County, Arizona, sends us the following telegram. We Western law enforcement officers rather enjoy the glamorous tradition of the old frontier, of shafts and six shooters. But we are really not as colorful characters as the public thinks. The old six shooters have been long ago supplanted by modern automatics, tear gas bombs, and machine guns. Our police problems are pretty much the same as those of any large metropolitan center like San Francisco or Los Angeles. We are nowadays as well equipped to battle the criminal army on the desert as are our brother officers in the city. How well equipped, you will learn from tonight's story of a manhunt conducted by my predecessor, Charlie Wright, in which every modern weapon we could command was brought into play in our battle to bring a notorious public enemy into custody. Late summer evening in 1929. The scene is a modest apartment in Wheeling, West Virginia.
That you, Irene?
Yeah.
Where you been?
I took Johnny to the movies.
Hey, it was a swell picture. Gee, there was all right a shooting and people got killed and everything.
Irene, do you realize that it's past 6 o'clock? Here I get home from a hard day at the shop and there isn't a bite to eat in the house.
Oh, lay off, will you? What do you expect me to do? Hang around this dump all day just to have hot beans on the table when you drag me.
Well, that'll be a lot better than taking that child to the picture show and exciting his mind with a lot of gangster pictures. Now, you gotta stop it, Irene.
I gotta stop it. You're telling me what to do?
Well, I have a right to. I'm your husband.
Listen what's talking. Now, look here, kid, and get this straight. I married you to get out of supporting my old man, see? And I've just about made up my mind I made a bad deal.
Irene.
Sure. This is the lowdown. I got ideas. I got plans, and you don't figure into them, see? There's a devil of a world where the men get all the breaks. I'm going to change all that. I'm going to find myself a real man. And I'm going to take what I want from the world, see?
Look here, Irene, you've been drinking.
Ah, what if I have?
You took Donnie into a speakeasy?
Yeah, I have swelled up this bubble.
Now, I forbid you to do that again, Irene.
You forbid me? That's hot. Now, you look here, my pretty. You ain't going to have no chance to forbid me again.
Well, where are you going?
Hunter to you. You'll never see me again. Come on, Donnie.
Are you going to see him on?
Sure,
Donnie. Plenty of them. You're going to stop living, kid. So Irene Schroeder leaves her husband, gets herself a job as a waitress, mulls over the injustice of this man's world, plans how she would change it. But plump, loud, hard-drinking, 140-pound Irene finds it difficult to ensnare a man to fit into her plans. Weeks go by. And then one icy fall evening, as she's on her way to work, she notices a good-looking man in the car stopped by a traffic light. As the bell clangs, Irene deliberately steps forward into the intersection.
Are you badly hurt?
I don't know.
I'm awfully sorry. I didn't see you. I guess here, let me get you into the car. Careful now.
My, you're strong.
What's that? Oh, yes. I try to keep in condition. There now, easy. You'd better let me take you to a doctor.
No, I guess I'm all right. I was on my way to work. I'll be late.
Are you sure you're all right?
Yeah, I must have slipped on the sidewalk.
It's terribly stupid of me. If there's anything I can do...
Drive me to work so I'm not too late.
Well, of course. Where is that?
The Monongahela restaurant. Just down the street here.
It won't take a minute.
What would your wife say if she knew you was driving around with a blonde?
Why, I guess I could explain it.
Oh, then you are married.
Oh, yes. Been married for 10 years. I got 2 kids.
Oh, I see. You got much fun out of life?
Yes, I suppose so. I teach Sunday school, and I'm scoutmaster of a Boy Scout troop.
Sounds thrilling.
Well, of course I...
I mean fun. Real fun. Dancing and drinking.
I don't drink.
No, I didn't suppose you would. Well, here we are.
Now, listen. Here's my card, and if I can do anything for you, I'll make it right. I feel responsible, you know.
As far as I'm concerned, there's only one thing you can do to make up for knocking me down.
Oh, what's that? I'll do anything.
Take me out to dinner and a dance some night.
Well...
Don't you think it'd be fun?
Yes, I'm sure
it
would.
Okay, that's the price.
Very well. When shall we say?
Tomorrow night. Meet you at that same corner at the same time.
Well, how about your job?
The devil with the job. I like you, baby.
Thanks.
It's a date?
It's a date.
So the fly walks into the spider's parlor. The first date leads to a second, and more follow. Dig... and snared by the scheming Irene, embezzles money from his employer, loses his job, deserts his wife and family. At last, Irene's plans have reached the point of action.
You ain't got no regrets, have you, honey?
Well, no, not exactly. But it's a little tough on Molly.
Oh, forget Molly. Could Molly ever give you this?
Oh, Irene.
You love me. Don't you, honey?
Yes. I love you. I love you.
Now, listen, kiddo. We're going places, you and I. I got plans. We're going to have one swell time. Glenn, how'd you like to travel? Get out for the open spaces out west. Get out of this dump.
Swell.
That's just what we're going to do.
Yeah, it's a swell idea, but how are we going to travel?
In my car, first.
Yeah, but what'll we use for money? How'll we buy gas and oil and food?
Easy. We just knock over what we need.
What do you mean, knock over what we need?
Oh, baby, you're so dumb. Look. Look what I got in this drawer here.
A gun.
A gat, honey. That's the way we're going to travel. This gap's our ticket.
You mean rob people?
Sure. Pick them up.
But Irene, I can't do anything like that. I don't want to break the law.
Listen, baby, and get this straight. You're in the deal. I love you, see? You can't do anything else but tag along with me. I won't let you go back to your wife, see? Before I'd do that, I'd turn this heater on you.
Irene, I believe you would.
You're Don Tootin', I would. I know what I want, and you're it. You don't have to worry about the rough stuff. I'll handle that.
You?
Sure. I'll show them whether a woman can be tough. I'll show them a new kind of racket dame. The kind that runs her own mob. We'll start on Monday when the stores have sales. A couple of stick-ups will finance us out of the state. We'll take my car, my brother Tom, and Donnie.
Oh, Irene, you're not going to take that child, are you?
Sure. This is a modern outfit. A 1930 model mob. No one will expect to find a woman and her kid in a mob car.
You can't do it, Irene. We'll all be killed.
Not us. Any killing that's got to be done, we'll do it.
But, Irene, it isn't right.
Listen, sweetheart. You're going along, see? But when it comes to business, I'm boss.
Pick up. Maybe murder.
Oh, forget it. Come on over here to the Davenport. There. Kiss me, baby. Now you're boss. You want to stick with me, don't you, honey?
Yes, honey. Yes. I want to stick to you.
So on December 27th, 1929... blonde, tough Irene Schroeder leads her strange mob of two men and a four-year-old child onto the path of crime. In Irene's car, to which she has affixed stolen Ohio license plates, they visit in rapid succession six Wheeling grocery stores, which donate the contents of their cash registers to the yawning poke of the blonde menace. And then, after the sixth job...
Well, that's enough for good old Wheeling.
What do you mean?
We got about 500 bucks, I guess. And by this time, most of the bulls in town are looking for us. We got to get out of town.
Where to next?
Cross the line to Pennsylvania. Duck Pittsburgh by way of Homestead and New Kensington. Head for Butler.
Why Butler?
I've been there once. I know a good spot to knock over there.
It is just past noon when the Schroeder gang rolls into Butler. Irene directs Dave to the Kroger grocery store. They pull up to the sidewalk, and Irene hands Dave an automatic.
Here you are, honey. Here's your plaything.
I thought you said I was only supposed to drive.
This is a big joint. I'm going to need help.
Yes, but Irene,
Come on, don't give me no argument. You just waltz in with me. Show the gun to the ladies, and they'll pass out from fear.
Yes,
only
but...
Only don't look so scared or they'll be on to you. Tom, you be on the lookout.
Okay.
Leave the motor running, sweetheart. And, Donnie, you stay here this time.
No, Mama. I want to go with you.
Not this time, kiddo. You stay in the car.
Gee, Mama.
I told you not to bring the kid with you.
Shut up. Now, Donnie, if you act like this, Mama won't get you that teddy bear she promised you. There. Now, that's better. Now, wait here for Mama like a good little man.
Okay, Mama.
Come on, Glenn. You see, all men are alike no matter how old they are. Promise them something, they'll do anything for you.
Meaning?
Oh, meaning nothing. On your toes now.
Yes, ma'am. Can I do something for you?
Yeah. Can you tell me the sale price on your canned peaches?
Why, yes. Let me see.
Don't bother looking. Just empty out that cash register.
What?
You heard me. Tell out. Come on, darling. Wave your gun at the ladies. All right, you dames. Sit down on the floor, all of you. I'll just dump all that dough into this shopping bag. Quiet, you hay bags, or my partner will have to drill a couple of you. Now, my friend, let's have the front door key.
The front door key?
Listen, stupid. I'm getting tired of repeating things to you. Give me the front door key and fast.
There you are.
Okay. Come on, baby. Our time's up. Back towards the door, you dummy. Keep your gun on him. All right, James, we're locking you in. If you want to live to go home and cook the old man's dinner tonight, stay put for 15 minutes. Okay, Glenn, get behind the wheel. Come on, Tom. We're all set now.
Just just the day before, the Pennsylvania State Police had inaugurated a teletype system connecting 95 police departments throughout the state. Only congratulatory messages had so far traveled over its wires. Now, for the first time, a crime of major importance is instantaneously ticked across the police network.
Pennsylvania State Police, broadcast one, woman, blonde, aged about 22, weight 140 pounds, and man about 30, stuck up grocery store in Butler at 12:15 p.m., traveling in high-powered car, believed heading toward Newcastle. Stand by.
Corporal Powell. Private Moore.
Yes, sir.
This teletype just came through. These bandits are thought to be heading this way. They want you to go out on the Butler Road and stop all cars coming toward Newcastle.
Yes, sir.
Now, boys, you keep your eyes glued ahead. I'm going to change my costume.
What's the big idea?
Those old hens will tell the boss every detail of the silk dress. I got to get into something new. Woo! Gosh, this thing is cold. Woo! There we are. Now you can look. Oh, boys, this is a light. It's a pushover, a spin. How about it, Glenn, honey?
Yeah, I guess you're right.
I'm right. But, honey, I'm warning you. You learn to hold that rod steady, or somebody will see your hand shake and let you have it. What's the matter? Ain't you got no guts?
I'll be okay the next time.
You better be. And take that. The first good look car you come to, stop.
Why?
We're transferring. When they start looking for this bus, we won't be in it, see?
Okay.
Now, who would suspect that the beautiful young lady traveling with her son, her husband, and her brother would be a holdup artist? Feel as a zap. Oh, God.
Hey, Irene, here's a car up here. No houses around. Looks like a Packard.
Good. Pull up. Oh, it's a honey. All right, boys, pile out. Men, help me move these bags. Tom, you yank those stolen plates off our car. Come on, work fast. Come along, Donnie.
Where are we going now, Mom?
I don't know. Texas, California, out west somewhere.
And will I see Indians?
Sure, you'll see Indians. Now pile in.
Gee, this is
fun. Sure, a lot of difference. This is a real bus. Get those plates, Tom?
Yeah.
Bags all in, Glenn?
Yep.
Didn't leave any signs of us in the old bus, did you?
Not a thing.
Okay, let's go. Boy, what a difference.
Some car, all right.
Oh, we got the jump on them now. None of these hick towns will know about the stick-up until tomorrow morning when they get the Pittsburgh papers. And by that time, we'll be halfway across Ohio. Halfway across Ohio. Halfway across Ohio.
Irene, look ahead. One of those highway patrol tracks.
Oh, you're seeing things.
No, I'm not. Two state cops in a car. They're blocking the road. I guess we'll have to stop.
Let me handle this. Oh, what's the trouble, officers?
I'm Corporal Paul, ma'am. This is my partner, Private Moore.
Oh, yeah?
This can't be the car, Paul. Two men and a kid in it. And this dame isn't dressed according to the description.
Oh, we'll see. Where are you from, ma'am?
From Greensburg. Just out for a ride.
I see. Now you there in the front seat. Let me see your license.
Okay.
You might have put clothes.
Yes, but the teletype didn't say nothing about a kid.
Oh, Corporal, my friend's just driving me. I have my license here.
Oh, well, may I see it, ma'am?
Yeah. Just reach in here. Stop the other one, Glenn. Okay, honey, now drive like you never drove before.
Look here, Irene. This is too much. I didn't contact the merchant.
Oh, shut up. You're in this gear with me. And if you try squirming out, I'll put you where I put that cop. Now drive.
But you hadn't ought to plug that cop, Irene.
Ah, you yellow, too. Guess I was right when I figured I had more guts than a dozen men.
Mama, you got him well, didn't you?
I'll say I did, Donnie. Right through the bread basket.
Yeah, just like in the movies.
Hey, to Glenn.
What?
There's a car coming towards us. Block the road.
Now, Irene, let's not have any more shooting.
You feel that in your neck, honey? Now shut up and do as I say.
All right.
What is this?
Climb out, you two.
Oh, Bob! He's got a gun.
Keep your trap shut and I won't use it. Now get out. All right, Tom. Get Donnie and the bags into this car. Glenn, you take the wheel. Hurry.
What are you going to do to us?
Nothing. Just borrow your car. All set, Glenn?
Okay.
Just a minute.
What's the idea of shooting the tires?
Just so they can't follow us. Let's go, honey.
Where's Tom?
What?
He isn't here.
They got yellow and took a powder, huh? Beat it into the brush. Oh, that's okay. We can't waste time looking for him. Only don't let that give you any fancy ideas, my sweet. You're sticking, see? To the very end. Now let's go.
Well, here we are in Newcastle. Where to next?
Let me see. The best way to throw them off is to go right back the way we come.
Irene, that'd be suicide.
Yellow?
No, but every cop in the county will be on that road now.
I'll stop that. Here, pull up by this drugstore.
What are you going
to
do?
Leave that to me. Where's your phone?
Right over there.
Oh, thanks. Hello. Hello, operator? Hurry, please. You mean the state police barracks? Hello? State police? Well, I just passed a green car that had a blonde woman in it. Yeah. And two men and a little boy. I think it's a bandit car you're looking for because the woman was waving a gun. Which way? Well, they was heading toward the Ohio state line. Yeah. Yeah, heading west. Well, not at all. Goodbye. Okay, sweetheart. Back to Butler and then to Wheeling.
Irene, I'll tell you it's the death sentence to go back
Forget
there.
I got that all fixed. By the time we get to Butler, they'll be looking for us in Ohio.
While the Ohio State Patrol blockades roads from Pennsylvania and a vain search for her, Irene rides unmolested back along her murder trail. Back in Wheeling, she buys Johnny a teddy bear, kisses him, and leaves him with his grandfather. Then she and Dig drop from sight as baffled police of three states fail even to identify the daring blonde bandit and murderer. While the public clamors for police action, officers are slowly piecing together their meager evidence. From witnesses of the holdup, from Private Moore, from the couple who were deprived of their automobile, they get descriptions. In the first car Irene abandoned, they discover an overlooked handbill from a store in Wheeling. Backtracking, they swing their search from western Pennsylvania into West Virginia, finally to the city of Wheeling. And at last, the search develops into the most tedious type of police work, a house-to-house canvas. Then one spring day, in a modest residential district of Wheeling, two state officers are half-heartedly conducting their futile search when a little boy playing with a teddy bear on the doorstep of a house waves to them.
Hey, my mommy sucks to a man like you.
What's that?
What? It's like in the movie. She pulled out a gun and let him have it.
Where is your mama now?
She's gone automobile riding with my new papa.
Thus, from the innocent, excited lips of little Donnie Schroeder, do police discover the identity of the blonde murderess. They question the child further. Eagerly, he tells them the details of the most exciting moment in his little life, unable to know that he is signing his mother's death warrant. From Irene's father, police obtain her photograph. They get her fingerprints. They issue circulars, broadcast them all over the country. But for 2 years, Irene Schroeder remains an unseen, unknown fugitive. 2 years during which little Donnie is watched day and night in the hope that the powerful force of mother love will bring the murdering mother back to her son. But Irene has disappeared completely, it seems. Florence, Arizona, January 13, 1931. A tall, lean man lounges in the shade of a hardware store, watching a stout young woman, clad in short khaki skirt, helping two men in Levi's load some supplies in the back of a car. There is something familiar about the woman. The tall man slowly saunters toward them.
I tell you, Irene, you ought to wear pants. All the dames do out here.
Listen, baby, I'm a woman, see? And I'm going to stick your skirt. I'll show all you guys I'm tougher than you are, and I'll never have to wear pants to do it.
Hey, get a load of this desert rat coming over this way.
The devil's he want.
Looks like the law to me.
Guess we know how to handle the law, huh, Glenn?
Right.
No shooting here in town, get me?
Beg your pardon, folks. Deputy Sheriff Chapman. Do you mind letting me look at your driver's license?
Yes, we'd mind.
Take him up. Hey, we don't look here now.
Put up. Get in the car.
Go on.
What's
going on
here? Okay, Glenn, let's go. 10 foot a mouth.
Kidnapping the deputy sheriff in broad daylight from the main street of Florence, the daring bandits swing out of town, head toward Superstition Mountain. But not before astounded onlookers have seen the sheriff snatched and realizing that the outlaws must pass through Chandler, have telephoned ahead and spread the alarm. Doing better than 70, Dig burns up the desert road. Then the squat buildings of Chandler appear ahead.
That's Chandler. Cut her loose. Don't stop for nothing.
Hey, they got a mob out waiting for us.
I'll take through them. They're gonna shoot. Duck low. Good boy, Clint. You're getting better all the time. Okay, let's get rid of the excess baggage. Come out the sheriff, Jimmy.
Okay. Come on, you're leaving.
And what?
You heard me, you're leaving.
Hey, get your hands off
me. Come
you.
On.
There it goes.
Now, everybody take a crack at him.
Chief, look at him bow.
Whoa, somebody winged him. All right, Clint, head for the hills. You know, Jimmy, it was just like the trip we turned back in Pensy when I bumped off that copper. I'd have been on that job with us.
Yeah, I bet. Only look, Irene, you don't know this country as well as I do. I've been born and raised out here. You got any idea where you're gone now?
Sure. We're hiding out in the mountains until the boys cool off. And if they come up for us, we'll shoot it out. We got lots of machine guns and plenty of gas. What's the matter with you, Glenn?
Nothing. I was just thinking about my kid.
That's hot. Thinking about your kids, huh? How about me? Ain't I a mother? Don't you think I wish my Donnie was here to see me handle a gat again?
I wasn't wishing my kids were here.
Oh, stop it. Don't get sentimental on me now.
Now, listen, Irene. If you want to get out of this mess at all, you got to get off the road.
What do you mean?
There's an Indian reservation up the road here. We'll have to get horses and beat it back into the Salt River Mountains.
Real Wild West stuff, huh?
Well, call it what you like, but it's our only chance.
Okay, we'll take it. We'll hold that posse off as long as we got a single slug left.
At the reservation, the three fugitives hire horses from Lone Sun Dust, an Indian trader. Hoisting provisions and ammunition on the saddles, they head for the high mountain. In a little sheltered patch of sagebrush, they throw their tired bodies on the ground for a brief rest. And then Irene busies herself cooking a thick steak for her men. Dig is lying on his back, looking up at the sky when...
Irene... There's a plane above us.
What of it? Watch a mail plane fly over the desert. Don't worry so much. What you need is some of this steak.
Listen, Irene. That plane isn't going any place. It's circling over us.
I'll fix him.
Drop that rifle, Irene. That'll give us away for sure. He's seen the smoke of our fire. Here, Glenn, help me throw this sack over it. I'll dump some water on it.
Hey, that's the last of our water.
I can't help that. He's diving on us.
Not under the rock. They've opened up the contact.
Lie down. Don't move anybody.
Okay. That means they found out where we are.
What do we do now, Irene?
Dig in. Back in those rocks there. Build ourselves a fort and fight it out. Come on, get busy.
Feverishly, the fugitives worked to build themselves a fortress against the hill. After 2 hours of Herculean effort, they dig themselves in and wait for the arrival of the posse. Another hour passes, and then Irene, scanning the valley below them.
Well, boys, the British have landed.
What do you mean?
There's the posse. Must be 100 of them.
Boys, here, open fire! Oh,
Irene, listen, don't murder anyone else. Surrender.
Let go of my gun. Come on, let him have it.
Irene, please.
Come on, sweetheart. Don't be a coward. Don't let him take us alive. Come on. Kiss me, baby. and tight. Now shoot. Shoot, kill the dog. Shoot him down.
Okay, darling. Let's die together. I love you.
And I love you. You yellow.
Tank, ma'am. Now stick your hands up.
I didn't know that you'd be coming that way.
Yeah, that's what we figured. Okay, cease firing. We got him.
Kiss me, Irene, once more. The show's over. Oh, but it's been worth it. Have you?
Come on, stop the mush. We gotta get you down to the jail by sunset.
Okay, Mug. See you later, Glenn.
Schroeder and Glenn Daig were quickly extradited to Pennsylvania, where in Newcastle they were tried and sentenced to die in the electric chair for the murder of Corporal Paul. Jimmy Wells, their Arizona partner, was sentenced to die for the death of Deputy Sheriff Chapman in Arizona. Until the moment she sat in the electric chair, the first woman to be executed in Pennsylvania history, Irene Schroeder never knew that it was the childish prattlings of her beloved Donnie which brought about her identification as the murderer Corporal Paul. The Sheriff's Office of Maricopa County, Arizona, polices a large and difficult territory. We are flattered that they have chosen Rio Grande cracked gasoline to power all emergency cars. Records show that these cars daily perform unusual feats of power and speed, yet get splendid mileage. Sheriff McFadden's judgment in selecting Rio Grande cracked gasoline is vindicated by his brother officers. Chief Davis of Los Angeles uses Rio Grande in all police cars under his control. So does Chief Wallman of Oakland. Chief Wallard of Tucson, Arizona also thinks Rio Grande makes the best gasoline for police cars. But I imagine you and millions of others wonder why cracked gasoline gives such unusual speed in all types of motors. I'll tell you why. It's because millions of dollars have been spent in research by the worldwide Sinclair Oil Organization to find a better way to refine gasoline. Sinclair engineers built the finest cracking plant in America for the Rio Grande Oil Company, and only Rio Grande can supply in this market gasoline that is cracked by this amazing process. From Rio Grande's refinery comes gasoline of unequal liveliness and energy, energy which motors know as police car performance.